So the first postulate was about the wave function. Okay. Wave function you can consider it almost similar to the vector. But usually we call it as a state vector. So it also represents particular state of the system. So that psi wave function is known as a state vector of the system. All the vector operations you have already learned, you can apply on the wave function. Okay. So these are all vector operations: addition, multiplication by scalar. Okay. The second postulate was about the operator. So the dynamical variables are represented by operators in quantum mechanics. Third postulate was about the measurement, about the expectation values or eigenvalues. Normally, we have to measure the dynamical variable, or we call it as observable, when the system is in a particular state. Then only we can measure the variable. Then that measured value is given by the expectation value of the operator. Expectation value we have already learned. This is the idea, expectation value. We have learned expectation value of anything. An operator is a operator is integral psi star a operator psi dx. So a can be anything, you can substitute for any operator a. So this is the way of finding the expectation value, because this is a continuous variable. Instead of summation we are using integration. Now I have just started the fourth postulate but not completed, so I will complete it now. So when two operators A and B, this is a new idea. So first three postulates speaks about wave function, operator, expectation value. Okay. Whenever we say expectation values, we also have to deal with the eigenvalues also. Eigenvalues. Sometimes expectation values can become the eigenvalues. If the system is in eigenstate, even sometimes a single measurement will give you the eigenvalues, correct values. If you are sure system is in eigenstate, a single measurement can lead to the exact value, which is the eigenvalue. But that is a very, probability is very less, so we are always go for expectation values. Then we are always on the safer side. Now for the postulate is about a new idea. Consider two operators. So when we say that they are commuting, or when we say that they are not commuting, non-commuting. So this is a general relation, AB not equal to BA. Means, suppose the wave function comes on the right side, here B acts on the first wave function, then on that result A acts. Here what happens is, A acts on the wave function first, then on that result B is acting. This need not be generally true. Okay? Sometimes it can be true. Operators can simply interchange their position. So we say that AB equal to BA. Then when this condition is satisfied, we say that they are commuting operators. If this is not satisfied, we say that they are non-commuting operators, or sometimes we say anti-commuting operators. Non-commuting or anti-commuting operators are the name for when this condition is satisfied. Okay. Now this AB equal to BA, you can write it as AB minus BA equal to 0. Or this is the short notation, commutator bracket, commutation bracket or commutator. Okay. So this is commut square bracket, A comma B means commutator. Commutation bracket or commutator. Okay. So if they are commuting, this is 0. If they are not commuting, commutator is not equal to 0. Okay. So this is the expansion of commutation bracket. Okay. So you can simply understand that the commutator, this is simply interchanging of position. So if two operators interchange their position, nothing happens to the system. That means they are commuting or they are simply like friends. Okay. Friends can, there is no hard and rule relationship between friends. Okay, they are ready to exchange their position, their roles, nothing happens to the system. But in this case, AB, operator A and operator B, not equal to 0, that you can take it as father and child, or husband and wife, or teacher and student, anything you can take as an example, teacher and student. So these are non-commuting operators. Their roles cannot be interchanged. Okay. So now I am the teacher, you are the student. Okay. Suppose one of you take my role and I am going to take your role as a listener. So question is the system behaves in the same way? Okay. If the system behaves in the same way, suppose I am the one of your student, Alex, or anybody. Okay. So now I am taking class and you are listening. Now we just interchange our roles. You take the class. I will simply listen. Okay. That is changing their position or changing their roles. Do they affect the system? If the system behaves in the same way. If the system behaves in the same way? No. System will behave differently. Maybe better or maybe bad, that we don't know. But system behaves differently. Okay. So that means these are non-commuting variables or non-commuting or anti-commuting operators, like that we call that anti-commuting operators. Is the idea clear? Now I will state the fourth postulate. Okay, the fourth postulate says that any pair of pair means two things. Any pair of canonically conjugate operators will satisfy I will explain each term. Heisenberg's commutation relation. Okay. Now you listen. This is the most important postulate, or which is the, we say that is the kernel of quantum mechanics, or the most important postulate. What it says, So I will explain. Any pair. Pair means two things. Okay. Any pair of canonically conjugate operators. Conjugate means what we now told non-commutative. Conjugate means non-commutative. Okay, or anti-commuting. Conjugate means anti-commuting. Canonically means you might have heard of canon laws. That is a biblical word, usually in Bible or in Old Testament. Canon laws are there. So canon laws means the belief is that the I think this word is maybe known to you. Canon means canon laws. That means the belief is that they are the laws directly given by God. So the belief is that you should not question that. It is fully accepted. If you question this canon laws, then that system will not exist or system will collapse. Okay? So these are canon laws. That is the meaning of canon, canonically. You will hear this word frequently in higher level physics, canonically conjugate. So you should not question that. Okay? So canonically conjugate operators, that means two non-commuting operators or canonically conjugate operators. Example is position and momentum. Position and momentum. This is one of the canonically conjugate operators. They are non-commuting operators or anti-commuting operators. I think you know this idea because these why it is like this? Because these two are having some uncertainty principle. This pair obeys uncertainty principle. I think that uncertainty principle is very familiar to you. Okay? So, this pair is a canonically conjugate pair. Another example is energy and time. Energy and time is a canonically conjugate pair. The uncertainty exists between these two also. Okay, so at least understand one pair, position and momentum. That is that these are the canonically conjugate pair. So if you question that there is no uncertainty between position and momentum, entire quantum mechanics is collapsed. Okay, that is why it is saying that these are canon laws. These are similar to canon laws. So that word or biblical words came into science with that meaning. That is some historical, maybe some historical reason is there. So that is why this word canon came into science. So these are canonically conjugate pairs. Okay. Now, so what is speciality with them? What is the speciality with them? They will satisfy Heisenberg's, that is the name of scientist, commutation relation. What is Heisenberg's commutation relation? Heisenberg's commutation relation is XP equal to, so is this zero? Is this commutation is zero? Do you interchange the measurement of position and momentum? First you measure position, then you measure momentum. Or first you measure momentum, then you measure position. is the results are same? Is the results are same? No, results are different. Okay, so you have learned that any measure, you measure x accurately, try to measure x accurately, that itself will make momentum uncertain. Uncertainty in momentum increases. Or the vice versa. If you try to make momentum accurate, uncertainty in position increases. If you make anyone accurate, the other become uncertain. Okay, so first you measure P or X, that is different. That gives different results. Okay, so this is not equal to zero. And what Heisenberg said, this commutation bracket is nothing but IH cross. Okay, this is the commutation relation. So this is the fourth postulate, which is the kernel of quantum mechanics, very important. Entire quantum mechanics is based on this relation. There are other things also, but main thing is this one, Heisenberg's commutation relation. You can put any pair, any canonically conjugate pair, not only X and P. You can put energy and time. Then also this is IH cross. Or angular displacement and angular momentum. That also IH cross. Okay. You can take any pair of canonically conjugate pairs and that will be equal to IH cross. Is that clear? This is actually something connected with the uncertainty principle. Actually comes from the uncertainty principle first, but Heisenberg told it in the mathematical expression, and that was very remarkable postulate, very important postulate. Okay, so we have learned the four postulates. Now we will move on to another topic, which is nothing but when we are going to apply this Schrodinger equation into some of the problems. First problem is particle in a box. Okay, so I have told you how to tackle the problem in quantum mechanics. That is the method I told earlier. You form the Schrodinger equation, either time independent or time dependent, which depends upon the potential. Okay, you choose time independent Schrodinger equation or time dependent Schrodinger equation. So that is a differential equation, second order differential equation. Now you solve that equation, you will get the wave function. That's the solution. You will get the psi wave function as the solution. Okay, then you check the solution, you modify the solution, and make it perfect, satisfying the circumstantial factors of the problem. Okay, so this is just remember, solving any problem in quantum mechanics is not so easy. Okay, this is a simplest problem. Actually, in quantum mechanics, problems can be divided into exactly solvable and not exactly solvable problem. Okay. Exactly solvable means you have a differential equation whose solution can be directly found without any much problem. But you can later see that most of the problems are not exactly solvable. Very few problems are exactly solvable. So one example is this particle in a box. Okay. particle in a box, then now in our next topics are like this. What remains in the in this semester is like this, solving these problems. Okay, first problem is particle in a box. Second problem is potential well. Then potential hill. Okay. Then we have linear harmonic oscillator. Okay. Then we have hydrogen atom. Okay. Only this much problems are. Or even you can consider the scattering problem also. Scattering problem. Only this much problems are exactly solvable. All other problems are very very difficult to solve in quantum mechanics because they end up with very difficult differential equations. So all other problems are known as you have to use some approximation methods. All other problems fall in this category, approximation methods. Okay. So in the remaining of your topics, these are the remaining topics. So we will discuss one by one. And particle in a box is the simplest problem. Okay. And for all our problems, difficulty level slightly increases. Okay. For that, now you consider a box. I am drawing a box with the walls. And consider a particle here inside the box. This is not there. This is outside of the box. So the box is having a width of L. Length of the box is L. Okay, and this is the particle inside of the box, and it is moving. For simplicity, let it to move one dimensionally in the x direction. Now y and z direction. So it first moves to here, and then it goes and hit the wall. And we assume that the wall is infinitely hard. Wall is infinitely hard. You assume that wall is infinitely hard. Okay. So inside the box, particle is having only kinetic energy. No potential is acting on the wall or on the particle. Okay, only kinetic energy is there. Particle moves and it hits the wall. What happens? The wall is infinitely hard, so nothing happens to the wall. Okay, so the particle rebounds, moves in this direction, minus x direction, and again reaches this wall. This wall is also infinitely hard. So the particle is moving back and forth without any loss of energy. That is the assumption. No loss of energy. Particle is having some kinetic energy, and when it hits the wall, the wall does not wall is not flexible. If wall is slightly moving, then that energy is lost for the particle. Okay, wall korchu ingane flexible anengil ee particle gane idikkumbol wall korchu ingane chulinju kaynal adu artham enna aa particle de energy upayogichittana wall korchu ingane chulugana adu artham particle de energy korayum ennaanu adu illade irikkan nammal assume cheyyanathu particle wall is infinitely hard athrakku hard wall aanu appo wall engane anagaram nikkum particle gane idichalum wall nonnu sambhavikkilla appo adonde ee particle ende energy ottu koravada adu thirichu move cheyyum So if a particle moves back and forth between the walls in the x direction and the no change of energy, that is our assumption. Is that clear? So now we at this point we call it as x equal to 0. The left end of the box is, we call it as x equal to 0, and right end of the, it is x equal to L. We mark the two boundaries. These are the boundaries of the particle. Particle can travel between x equal to 0 and x equal to L. Particle cannot go beyond x equal to 0 and x equal to L. Only motion is restricted between x equal to 0 and x equal to L. Is that clear? So the motion is, I will tell that is known as the boundary condition. Motion is restricted between 0 and L. So we can say that, let x is the position of the particle, then we can say that 0 less than or equal to. Particle can go up to 0, or x can be greater than 0 and less than or equal to L. This is the boundary condition. Motion is restricted between x between 0 and L. This is known as boundary condition. Okay, boundary condition. This we have to apply later for the solution. So that is why I am telling now, initially, this is a boundary value problem. Okay? So motion of the particles are restricted by boundaries, in the boundaries. We have two boundaries, so the motion is restricted between the boundaries. Okay, so now let us form the Schrödinger equation and solve it. Remember, this is the simplest problem. Now we have the Schrödinger equation. You can remember U psi equal to H psi. From that you can develop the expanded form of Schrödinger equation. I think these are familiar to you, so I am simply writing the Schrödinger equation. D square psi by dx square plus 2m by h cross square e minus v into psi equal to 0 is the time independent Schrödinger equation. So this is the time independent Schrödinger equation. Why we chose time independent Schrödinger equation? Because potential is actually on the walls. Okay, infinite potential. Particle normally inside the, when the particle is inside the box, particle experience no potential at all. Only thing is that when it comes and meet the wall, the particle gets bounced due to the infinite hardness of the walls. Okay? Okay? So this is the Schrödinger equation. So we have to, actually there is no potential, so we can easily choose the time independent Schrödinger equation. So if potential is there, you have to analyze whether it is time dependent or time independent. Accordingly, you have to choose time independent or time dependent Schrödinger equation. But for degree, we are treating only time independent cases. We are not at all considering any problem which is time dependent. So you don't worry. Always you can choose time independence or the regression. Time dependent case means little complicated, so we will deal with only in the higher level classes. So you can also always choose safely this equation as the Schrödinger equation for degree classes. We can always choose time independent Schrödinger equation. Is that clear? Now we can put what is the value of V potential. Do particle experience any potential? Most of the time, no. All the time, particle does not experience any potential. So we can safely put V equal to 0. So this is the second step. You identify the potential. First, write the Schrödinger equation. Secondly, you identify the potential and substitute for that. So here V is 0. Potential is 0. So this equation becomes d square psi by dx square. Without this V, I can write in the next page, I will write. So the Schrödinger equation becomes C d square psi by dx square plus 2m by h cross square E psi equal to 0. Okay. This is the differential equation. Now we have to solve this differential equation. See, this entire thing is a constant. 2m, m is the mass of the particle, moving particle, E is the energy, kinetic energy of the particle, h cross, we know, all things are constant, 2 is a constant. So you can call this constant as, you call this constant as k square, 2m E by h cross square, you call it as k square. Okay, then the differential equation becomes d square psi by dx square plus k square psi equal to 0. Now this is a simple form. You can very easily solve this. What is the meaning of this differential equation? What is the meaning of this differential equation? When you differentiate psi 2 times, you should get minus k square along with the psi. That is the meaning of this differential equation. You differentiate, first term is you differentiate psi 2 times with respect to x. You should get psi with the minus k square as a multiplier. So when you differentiate, you get the same thing when you choose sine function or cosine function or exponential things. Okay, you get the same thing. Okay, so you can choose, one option is you can choose cos kx, cos theta. When you differentiate cos kx, you get differentiate 2 times cos kx, what happens? You get minus, first time you get, time is almost over, so I will discuss the solution in the next session. Either you can choose cos kx or you can choose sin kx with the constants a and b and the combination of that. This will I will explain in the next session after 15 minutes. Okay.